Welcome to NWA Cane Corsos Podcast, where we talk all things dogs.
Hey, everybody. Welcome back to another show, NWA Cane Corsos, where we talk all things dogs. Welcome back. And we have another special guest, the Maligator Mom in the house. So I'm going to let her do the pleasure of introducing herself and telling a little bit about herself.
Awesome. Yeah. Well, cool. Thanks so much for having me, first of all. I love to come on, and I think we have a shared passion for just education around specific breeds, right? You more so with the Corsos, me more so obviously with Malinois. And that's kind of my aim. I have come online and tried to create a presence around breed education. And that kind of morphed into offering training both in person and virtually. And I've kind of turned it into a nice little side hustle, I guess. Something that was at first, I think, a hobby has now turned into something that I've been able to monetize successfully. And I'm just enjoying it. I'm really having a good time. I'm really glad to be here. I love an opportunity to come on and talk about the breed that holds a very special place in my heart. And be, you know, kind of the conduit there between people who are trying to learn more about the breed, which is great. And then just kind of being lost in the weeds of where to go, especially on social media. Everybody's a false prophet, it seems nowadays. It's very easy to get bamboozled. And so, I just do my best to share my information and point out people that I think people should be paying attention to that are the real deal. And, yeah, that's kind of what I'm aiming to do.
There we go. I like that. So, when did you get interested in the Malinois or dogs, period? When was your first love?
Oh, my gosh. You know, it started about 7 or 8 years ago now, I think. And it actually happened because I was out in public at an event, and there was a live demo. There was a dog training company that had come out to do a live demo of their protection dogs. And I saw this woman, and she sent these two Malinois on these two different guys in opposite directions. And one jumped on the hood of a car, and like, it was this whole big thing. And they were doing it live in front of all these people. And I was just like, oh my gosh, I've got to learn how to do that. I want to learn more about that. I want to be someone who can handle a dog like that. How do you train a dog to do something like that? I was just taken, right? I was like, I've got to figure this out.
Wow.
It ended up being a phone call to that company. And then fast forward all these years later, that person at Global Canine Protection Services, shout out to them, out here in Nashville, the head trainer there, Courtney Robbins, is now my best friend. And now we hang out, we train dogs. And she's taught me most of what I know, to be totally honest with you. She was just a huge foundational figure for my learning and training and how I approach, you know, all of this with Malinois. And she's just a great trainer all around. I'm really lucky to have made that connection out here, because I think they're kind of hard to find in the Malinois community, to be honest with you. So I think I got very lucky right out the gate. But that's how I saw it. It all started just seeing a live demo and being like, I've got to learn how to do that.
So you train dogs, and you have a really big presence on YouTube and Instagram. I was seeing. So are you 100% dogs? That's what you normally mostly do now?
Yeah, you know, right now I've kind of pivoted, and I'm doing a lot of virtual stuff.
Okay.
So right now, what I have found, right, is that most people who are interested in dog training are having a really hard time going out and finding good education and training education. And it seems that the only way to do that really is to attend training seminars, right? Which is awesome. And I've been to my fair share all across the country and even internationally to go learn and train. But that's just not always something that everybody can do. It's not feasible for everybody, you know, geographically, financially. Like, there's all these challenges. You have commitments between kids and family and home, and everybody has a full-time job and things going on. And it's like, it's just not practical. And so I'm trying to kind of usher in, you know, an opportunity for people to attend what would be seminars, but virtually. And so right now, my big projects that I'm trying to focus a lot on are bringing a lot of these really good trainers into the same space and virtually holding seminars, big seminars. Like, the next one I'm doing is a 30-day seminar. It's a month long with access to I've got Oscar Mora, who I know you were saying was on your podcast recently. Mm-hmm. Nino Drawart, Jonathan Katz. If you guys are into PSA, you know who he is. Larry Crone, right? Justin Rigney, Dave Croyer, IGP champion. And bringing them all into one place for an extended learning, virtual learning opportunity.
That's crazy.
Well, yeah, it's really fun too. They're really, everybody's on board with it, and I've got no pushback or anything. Everybody's super happy to collaborate, and I'm excited for it.
Yeah, I know when I hollered at Oscar, I was just surprised how willing he was just to just do it. I was like, all right, it's good to run into people who don't mind working, spotlighting each other for a common cause, because a lot of times I think people are just afraid to put attention on someone else.
If we can be frank here on the podcast,
you can be as frank as the hell you want to be.
Okay, all right, well, I'm gonna just say it then. I feel like the dog training community as a whole is not a super welcoming community. I think that especially around sport training, I see a lot of people who feel a little overly competitive. I think that there's kind of this idea, right, that there's not enough seats at the table. Mm-hmm. And why would you promote or collaborate with another trainer? You're directly giving them business that could potentially be yours. And I think that that's just a failure to see like the overall picture, right? If this is a trainer that you respect, somebody that you've worked with, somebody you've learned from perhaps, or mentored under or with, or, there's really nothing wrong with collaboration. Collaboration is what people that are at the top are doing.
Right.
Yeah. So that's kind of how I think about it. So it's a green flag for me if you're willing to collaborate. If you're not, and it's a shutdown and you're not willing to do stuff like this, or, collaborate or be on other people's, media.
Right.
That's kind of a red flag for me. Right. It's like, well, why? I don't get it.
I see that a lot, being that I cover a lot of breeds and I cover different trainers. I see exactly what you mean. But it shouldn't be that way. You're in front of my audience. I'm probably in front of your audience. Everybody get to see the information. There's nothing hidden.
Everybody eats.
Yeah, everybody eats at the end of the day. So,
yep.
Yeah. So you said that you saw this demo and you got with this company. How long did you feel before you had a good foundation in training dogs?
That's a great question. Wow. I would say the fundamentals can come pretty quickly, to be honest with you. Yeah. I mean, I think the fundamentals come quickly. I think that there's always room for improvement, but I think the fundamentals, you can have them down and be really good, especially if you have an aptitude, right? Like, not everybody has an aptitude. It's not as easy for everyone as it is for some, and that's something that I've seen being a trainer, working with people in person and virtually. Some people have to work harder at it. Some people really do have an aptitude and a special talent for it that just emerges, right? And other people have to rely more on competency than talent, right? So it's one of those things that that's just very person handler specific. Mm-hmm. But I think within the first year, I felt like I had a good foundation on the fundamentals of training a dog. When I wanted to get into more advanced stuff, right? Like, okay, now I want to talk about off leash, right? Obedience, or getting into the realm of protection, which I still do not teach protection to anybody. But getting into the realm of that type of training, that takes years, like honestly, years, before I felt like I was comfortable enough in my knowledge to step into the space of being comfortable taking people's money for my information.
Right.
Right. And I think that there's always a level of imposter syndrome that people have. And I think that that's healthy. I think we should feel that way to a point. But still, knowing that I did seem to know quite a bit more than most people, feeling like I had value to bring, that's when I knew. And that probably took, 3 or 4 years before I felt comfortable in that space.
Do you think when you begin, I know that I'm just a basic, practical, wouldn't even call myself a trainer. I need training help. I stay in my lane. You know what I mean? But I always think that trainers have a sixth sense for dogs. Did it seem that way for you starting out?
100%. 100%. I think that's kind of what we were touching on, is as far as like some people have more of an aptitude for it, mm-hmm. and some people have to work harder.
Right.
I mean, I've worked with some really, really amazing, organically talented trainers, right? And so when I think of that, I think immediately of my good friend Nino Drawart of STS Canine. Mm-hmm. Hands down, I've worked with lots of trainers all over. He is the most organically talented trainer I've ever witnessed. And not by a little, a big margin, right? Like right, he's right. incredible. And then I've also worked with some trainers who are incredibly competent, right? But they struggle with simple things, maybe like movement and luring and fluidity. And they don't really have a lot of elegance in their training, mm-hmm. right? And so, you know, it's one of those things where you try, I think the goal is balance, mm-hmm. but whatever your natural talents or your shortcomings are, dog training will reveal them.
Gotcha. I'm gonna come back to some training, but I want to know a little bit when you started with the Malinois, some of the traits, because you know when people talk about Malinois, they just think, oh, neurotic. You know what I mean? How has this
totally been wrong?
Yeah. Okay. Explain this dog to us a little bit for those who don't know about this dog. Can it be a family dog?
Absolutely. And that's one of the things too that I think is a little different about my messaging than most, right? I think what I see is a lot of very well-intended gatekeepers of the breed. And I think that their heart is in the right place. But I do believe that these dogs are very capable of being loving family companions, right? Mm-hmm. So far as you are able to meet their needs genetically outside of just expecting them to be a well-behaved pet. So, you know, Malinois, of course, they're herders for starters, right? A lot of them are just born with oral fixation. So they are very mouthy dogs, just, you know, genetically. They are built, you know, just to have higher drive, right? So these dogs have a lot of energy. And if you don't know where to put it or how to leverage it, then you're going to really struggle to have a cohesive relationship with a dog like that. So when you think of bringing a Malinois into the family, there needs to be special considerations outside of just the typical, pet dog that you might be thinking of bringing on board, right? Right. What kind of training you're going to be able to offer the dog, how much time you have to give the dog. But then there's, you know, the flip side of that where people, there's this narrative out there, and I don't even know where it came from, but it's you need to spend a minimum of 3 to 4 hours a day training your Malinois. And that is just absolute nonsense. Like, I don't know where that comes from, but I see it all the time on social media. Mm-hmm. I know a lot of really talented trainers with dogs that do amazing things, and they do not spend 3 to 4 hours a day training their dog. Right. Okay. So it's, you know, the time commitment needs to be there, but it's not outrageous and it's not impossible to have one of these dogs, work with these dogs, and have them also be a great family companion as well, to be around your children, to be, you know, cohesive with other pets. You know, those things are very possible. It's just a commitment.
How many Malinois do you have?
Currently 3.
3.
Yeah.
When you said leverage the energy, what are some ways that you do that?
Oh, gosh. Well, leveraging energy, right? It's a lot about management. So when you consider that I am someone who lives at home, works from home, that means I have a lot more time on my hands than most people do. So I'm already kind of up on most people, right? Because I'm with them all day. Mm-hmm. But I also have 4 kids and a husband and a very busy life. And I have to manage their energy throughout the day. So they're on a very strict schedule, a very strict routine that kind of helps me maintain, a day that I can get through, right? So what you don't see typically, if you watch my social media, what you don't see typically is all 3 of my Malinois in my house at one time.
Yeah.
Right? Does it happen? Sure. And can they? Absolutely. But do I want to worry about managing all of that energy? No, I don't. So I just don't die on that hill, right? It's just more about managing everybody and making sure that their needs are met so that when they do come in, they're not in a state of drive where they're pent up all day or they've been kenneled all day and they've got no outlet for their drive or their energy, right? We have to meet those needs to expect that behavior, to have that off switch.
Yeah, yeah. And thank God for my wife, because she stays at home and she's able to do the same things that you're talking about. Like, I know it's a big deal about people and kennels and dogs and things like that. My dogs don't have that relationship where they don't want to go back in the kennel. You know,
right?
You have to manage the time and let them out, play with them, all that good stuff, you know. And do you have a problem with all your dogs being out, or do they all get along?
Oh, no, they get along. They do. I just recently was able to introduce my youngest and smallest dog to the pack because my oldest male does not like puppies or little dogs. And he will hurt a puppy or a little dog. Mm-hmm. And so I have to be very careful and very slow about how I introduce them. So it was something that I worked months and months and months and months on. And they're finally now to a point where now my little dog, who is this little, he's just this little abomination. I don't know what he is. He's some type of doodle mix. I got him out of a parking lot in the back of a van at Target. I don't know what he is. He needed a home. I took him home. Wow. But he's now running with my pack. And it's quite a sight to see. He's about this big, you know, and he's just out there with all the Malinois, and he thinks he's one of them. And they all get along and they have a good time. But again, it takes an approach. It takes a strategy. It takes thoughtfulness. It takes time. And, you know, especially when you have a dog who, you know, isn't going to be too keen on a little dog, you know, you don't want to put them in a situation where they're not safe. And so, yeah, but we've got to that point where everybody's good. You know, there's the occasional squabble, but nothing crazy.
Yeah, those squabbles, they always
they're gonna happen.
Everybody yelling, ah!
Yes, exactly.
I'll try to calm the whole family down, you know, then take care of the dog. Yeah, so you've done an excellent job. I didn't even get through a lot of your content. I was like, golly, she's really got a lot of information and things like that. You even get down, y'all go, first off, y'all go to her channel. It was a really good video you had on kennel setups, vehicle setups and things like that. So it was just a lot of information she covered over there. Let me ask you this one. Back on the training. And if you're training someone virtually, how much focus do you put on the handler? Do they have to send you video to see the mistakes they make and things like that? How does that work?
Yeah, good question. So virtual training can go one of two ways. Most of the time, it's going to be a consult because that's what people want. Most of the time, and there's no shame in this, and I will sit down and I will talk to you about your dog for as long as you want, but most of the time, that's what it is. Most of the time, people call in and they want to do a virtual consult, or it's just a face-to-face like you and I are now, and they want to talk about the dog, talk about potential problems, and come up with some kind of troubleshooting as far as what they can do. My favorite type of virtual training, though, is a working session where you set your camera up and you're either in your training room or in your yard or wherever you train, and you've got your earbuds in so I can walk you through what to do, right? And those sessions are great. That's where I see the most growth is when we can do actual working sessions virtually rather than just the consults. So that's typically, right, what I will do. But when I have my my courses that you can take with me, so my next course is actually February of 2025, I actually do mentorship throughout the entire month of that program. So I will send you videos, tutorials, challenges. You will record yourself, send it back to me, and I will do a live demonstration and virtual coaching and send that video back to you. And that seems to work well for people who are really struggling to find the balance between, I don't have either the time or I'm geographically limited. There's no good trainers in my area, right? I can't get to where I need to go to train with someone with a dog like this.
Sure.
And it seems to be really good for people who are trying to manage their time to get in front of a good trainer, but not be able to necessarily outside of that, especially with time commitments and things. So you can do it at your leisure. Right? Like I'm kind of stickly on you though. I follow up with people. Hey, I haven't got that video today. I want to get that video today. Right. So I'll definitely kind of coax you along to keep you on track for sure. But that's part of coaching. I think that's what people need. Right.
That's right.
So that's kind of how it goes, but, we've had great feedback. People love it. I'm having a good time doing it. And, I just love that it's something that you can do when you have the time to do it. Cause sometimes it's just a lunch break, you know, you're working, you have an hour to come home and grab a sandwich and work the dog real quick, shoot a video of it, send it to me and go back to work. Right.
Yeah.
That's incredibly helpful for most people who have busy schedules.
Yeah. How long does a session usually, what's the sweet spot on the length of your sessions?
So a lot of people will book an hour, which is fine. And I think that that's probably the sweet spot, but we don't spend the whole hour working. To be honest with you, I probably spend about 20 or 30 minutes actually doing something with the dog. Mm-hmm. And then we talk about it. We come up with a plan. I'm really big on tell me what you thought about your session, right? Because what I see very often as far as people training and coaching is what I call joystick trainers, where it's just the trainer sits back and tells you what to do, right? And then when you're making a mistake, they offer you a real-time correction and tell you, oh, nope, do it this way. Nope, hold it here. Nope, turn left, right? And they joystick you through an entire session.
And, Oh, yeah, right.
And it's just not an approach that ever made me progress. It stagnated me when I worked with trainers like that. And so what I like to do is give someone a scenario, set them up, tell them how it should go and how it should look, what I want them to execute. And I let them go give it a shot. Right. Gotcha. Then I want them to tell me, all right, what do you think? It didn't go as planned. So where do you think it started to go off into the weeds? Or what do you think you could have done differently there? Because when you get people in that mindset, then you're developing their analytics as a trainer.
Gotcha.
Right. But when we're joysticking them through everything, they're not developing their skill set. They're just kind of come to you, and it's great as a trainer. They'll come back to you every week and give you money, right? Mm-hmm. Which you know, that's what it is. But I want to see people progress to the point where they don't need to call me anymore. You don't need to, you don't need to work with me anymore. Now you have the keys to the kingdom, right? Now you have all the information you need to go troubleshoot your own sessions. Mm-hmm. Like that's my goal as a trainer when I work with someone.
Clicker versus the voice. which do you prefer?
You know, I do both. I'm going to be honest with you. In a perfect world, I would choose the clicker over voice all the time. That's just me. It's consistent, right? But it's inconvenient. You know, where's the clicker, right? Like I'm constantly, where's my clicker? Like I can never find one. There's never one just convenient for me to grab. So if I do have one, I will click and say yes at the same time. Or sometimes I'll work exclusively with the clicker. And then if I need to, I'll work exclusively with my voice if I don't have a clicker. And I promise you, my dog absolutely understands. Yep.
So, but you give in the combination of the clicker and your voice, just in case you don't have a, cause I never have a clicker. I'd be like, come here. So you would say for most of your clients, they're going to use the voice, or do you?
Most of them do. Yeah. Okay. Most of them choose to use a voice. I think it's the path of least resistance, right? Which is something that most people, you know, fall into. Your voice is always on you. Your clicker, God knows what junk drawer it's in.
Yeah. Yeah. So what about treats? What kind of treats have done the best for you in training?
Yeah. So I don't actually train with treats. Which, I don't. What I actually do is I train with their food. So for a Malinois specifically, I feel like I get a lot of attention from my dog. The food drive comes out, right? When they're working for food, when they're working for their next meal versus taking the value away from food because they know they're going to get it. If that makes sense, right? Yeah. So if they know that they're going to get their food in a bowl at, let's say, 7 a.m. and noon and 7 p.m., then all of a sudden the value of food is tanked a little bit. And I personally like working with a dog who has very high food drive. So I don't let my dogs eat for probably the first 12 months of their life unless it's straight from my hand.
Gotcha.
And they have to do things to earn it. They have to perform to earn the food.
Right, right. When you started with the Malinois, did you start them as puppies, or did you, were they a little bit more developed when you got them?
No, puppies. We're talking babies. Yeah, I love puppies. Puppies are my thing. I really enjoy working with puppies. I really enjoy working with new handlers that also have puppies. Mm-hmm. I think that that it's really important for all dogs, but it's really, really important for Malinois to have a really good first 16 weeks of life.
That bond.
Yeah. Yep. Mm-hmm. Like those first 16 weeks are weeks that you can never get back. And a lot can go right, but a lot can go wrong that will really write on the soul of who that dog becomes later on in life, right? A lot of that stuff happens in those first 16 weeks. So so I have a kind of a passion for working with puppies and working with new handlers with puppies.
So about genetics, do you choose your dogs coming off particular lines, or what inspires you to go pick a puppy?
Yeah. You know, I don't. So here's the thing though. Mm-hmm. Right. And I will admit that I think that genetics and breeding and lineage and all of that is so far out of the depth for me. It's so complicated. There's so many lines. There's so much to consider and to look at and to know that I absolutely rely on people who know those things mm-hmm. to point me out, you know, to litters that I should be looking at or paying attention to. Right. So I'm lucky enough to kind of have, you know, networked with some people and developed some relationships with people who I can rely on to say, hey, you know, I'll send them a link. There's this, should I look at these puppies? And it's, you know, either thumbs up or nope, don't worry about it. Pass on that. And I heavily rely on their recommendations, but I, you know, mad respect to you, 'cause I know it is a lot. It is a huge commitment to be, to even have a toe into that breeding world is, a massive amount of information and stuff that goes into making those decisions.
Right, right. And then too, I've talked to a lot of trainers. Some of them don't care when it comes because they train so many different dogs. They're like, that don't even matter to me.
Yeah.
You know, right. Yeah. At some point, I guess it don't, because I guess once you've been in it so long, you're going to figure out ways to get that dog to do whatever you need to do. And seeing different breeds and things like that. I hear a lot of different, you know, you got to be patient with the breed. You got to, you know.
Yeah, but genetics, I think, are always going to give you the best shot.
Well, that's true.
Yeah. Right? Like we definitely want to follow the genetics, because you're going to have the best shot of getting the traits and qualities that you're looking for. Exactly. When you can look back into that line and be like, okay, well, are those things presenting, you know? Or not, right? But you at least you have that information to make an assessment. Yeah. And it's still a shot in the dark. I freely admit that, right? Like it could still be a complete shot in the dark. You could have a litter, I've been through it myself, of great, you know, I had this KNPV line, this beautiful, you know, litter that I was picking from. Mm. And I had two dogs, they were completely different, right? Mm-hmm. Like one was fantastic and the other was kind of a dud. Went on to be, you know, in a pet home, right? Just an active pet lifestyle. Mm-hmm. But you wouldn't have thought that from the genetics, you know? So it's still kind of a shot in the dark, but it's still best practice to follow the genetics, because it gives you a better chance.
Right, right. I had a breeder come on and he said something that will always stick with me. He said, if you're looking for a particular style of dog, one of the most important thing is to look at the breeder's lifestyle. So if I wanted a working dog doing the things you do, I'll be looking at you for the type of dogs that you know. So
right.
Lifestyle is very important. That's a good point. This is going to be so you do a little protection dog work, right? Or you're in sports, right?
Yeah.
Okay. PSA.
Yes.
How's that journey been?
Oh gosh, it's been a journey, I'll tell you that. So I only have one dog that I feel like I was going to be capable of competing with, and I knew that she had some limitations as far as, you know, she's always been a very naturally suspicious dog, right? Mm-hmm. So she's very high in defense, and that makes it kind of difficult to work her as far as like what her thresholds are, right? The margin is very thin. And so that means that I have to work with decoys that can work within that really thin margin slowly and progress her very slowly. So she's not, I'd say, the best genetically built dog, right, for this sport. That being said, she still has fun doing it, and I have fun doing it. And so I was like, you know what, we're going to go for it. We went for our PDC on our home field. She didn't pass, right? She made it through obedience. She's great in obedience. It's protection where she kind of falls apart because she's a very suspicious and very has very high defense drive. And so then we went out, we regrouped, right? We went out to Jonathan Katz. We spent the summer out there kind of working with him for a couple weeks and got her ready. And then we passed out there at Dogma and she earned her PDC and we began working towards her one after that. And now I've kind of backed off a little bit because I've had some other projects come online where it's just kind of, you know, taken priority, right? But I really do hope to eventually get at least the first leg of her one. I'd love to close her one out. I don't know if it's possible, but I'd love to, you know, I still feel like that's possible for us. I just don't know that she's the dog that's going to be very well suited to go any further than that, right?
I think
a one for her would be amazing. If we could accomplish a one for this dog, I am so over the moon satisfied with that, which again speaks right to genetics, you know, like not all these dogs are built the same, you know, and that's something that I think as handlers, we have to be really cognizant of and be willing to pivot our goals or accept our dog's shortcomings, right? And work within them. And also know when to wash a dog, right? Know when to pass on a dog. You know, not all dogs are the same.
When you have a protection dog, I want to know your opinion on this because this is a I'm kind of throwing you in the fire now. So if you have a protection dog, whether it be sports or street protection, you know what I mean? When you have visitors, do you think you should put this dog up? Or it should be under enough obedience where you shouldn't have to put the dog up when you have visitors?
Absolutely should not have to put the dog away.
Wow. Okay, good.
No way. Right. Like a truly trained protection dog, in my opinion, is the highest, most elite level of training you can possibly accomplish with a dog, period. And I mean exceeding military training, exceeding police training. I mean, it is the pinnacle of dog training. And those dogs have to reliably be able to move about the world, right, in their environment and be stable, be solid, you know, be of solid mind, right? Good nerves, be social enough, you know, to be out in public, but boy, turn it on when you want them to and turn it right back off when you're done. And that takes a very special dog. Those dogs are unicorns. You know, like there's a lot of dogs that start out in their training as 1 year old young dogs, right? Who just don't make it through, you know, and so they stop their training at a deterrent level or something.
People don't understand. A lot of people don't understand about that off button is just as important as that on button.
Yes.
You know what I mean?
Yes, so, absolutely. Yeah. If you send a dog to bite, you better hope you can recall them.
Wait. Right. Not him.
Exactly. Yeah.
So, and another topic I always run into is a sport dog versus a protection dog. So do you believe that, okay, say you train a dog for a sport and God forbid it was ever a situation where you think you might have to use him in a real life situation. Do you think that dog will protect without equipment or anything like that? What are your thoughts on that?
Some of them, yes. Some of them, no. Okay. Some of them know this is very situational, very contextual for the dog. But depending on the dog, some of them, absolutely. Like I know my dog Storm, she would nuke you if she, you know, like, like absolutely she would bite. But she's also not solid or stable to be out in public, right? Like she has, she has some issues. So, but I know some dogs that compete at high levels of sport that I think absolutely that I know absolutely would engage, right? Outside of the sport field for sure.
If someone was to ask you or get tips on you about going into the sports side, what are some good, bad, ugly advice you can give them?
Well, so I will tell you, I'm very new to the sport, right? Like, I've only been in the sport for about a year and a half. So I'm new to it, but I do have a lot of connections within the sport training, you know, area, right? And I think that the best way to do that is to just remain Switzerland. I think there's a lot of niches in the sport world. There's a lot of it's not super welcoming, right? And I hear that across the board from people who are trying to get involved in sport, is that it's just not a welcoming environment. And I get that, but I do try to play a little bit of devil's advocate here, because being in it, I also understand why that is, right? So the reason, so if you're someone who's out there right now, I'm talking to you, if you're trying to get into PSA or you're trying to get into some kind of dog sport and you're feeling unwelcome, or there's pushback, or you can't get a club to let you train with them or whatever, and you can't figure out why that is, let me do a little bit of devil's advocate here and explain why.
Okay.
The reason why is because the level of commitment that it takes to compete. So if you have a club that is actively competing, right, these are folks that are traveling, spending thousands of dollars, they're training consistently. And I mean consistently, right? Like daily, or their club is meeting two or three times a week, right? Like it's a huge commitment. And what you will see as being a part of a club like that on the outside, more often than not, is that people come in and they want to get involved and they're all for it. Until maybe month two or month three, right? And when it starts to get real and it's like, oh God, I have to go out to club again, you know?
Yeah.
And then they fall away. And now you have wasted what are very valuable minutes on the field training your dog that you actually are actively competing with, right? And committed to, giving those minutes away to people who aren't taking it seriously. Yeah. So if you are serious about it, then my advice would be, number one, ask to go watch at club, not participate in club. Mm-hmm. While you're watching, be helpful, right? Is there anything I can do? Does anybody want me to take pictures, help clean up the field, bring the decoys water? Be a presence there that is helpful to the club, even though you're not there training with your dog. And the second thing I would say is show up there for 6 months or so, right? Consistently to train with their trainers outside of the context of club. Show up and train with these trainers and pay them for their time outside of the context of club. Go work with your dog, go work with them. You need that one-on-one time anyway to progress.
Right.
You know, when you're doing like a club day, right? Like I'll give you an example. I drive an hour and a half there and an hour and a half home, and I get maybe 20 minutes on the field, and I'm there for like 5 hours. So it's like a 7 hour day, right? And I get maybe like 20 or 30 minutes of training time.
Oh, wow. Okay.
You know, and that's how club goes, right? So like, that's the level of commitment we're talking about. Mm-hmm. And if you want to step into that level of commitment, you like show us you show up and want to pay for our time and train with us for, you know, an hour, you know, a week for 6 months, right?
Right, right. Because it's just like anything. Like this kind of sounds like my son's wrestling club. When you join one of those organizations, I bet people say, I bet they don't last 1 month.
Right? So yeah.
People need to see your commitment and things like that. Yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
That's what it boils down to.
Yeah. Yeah. And then too, something I like to point out is when you said just kind of go watch, you might want to make sure it's a good fit for you. Cause I don't, to be straight up, I'm not working with nobody I don't like. You know what I mean? I'm just not going to do it. It's not going to work out in the end. You know what I mean?
Yep.
Yeah.
You gotta enjoy those people there. You know, are these people that you click with, you know, are they people that you want to spend a lot of time with? Cause you're going to be spending a lot of time with them.
That's right. That's right. What are your thoughts on, I know I'm all over the place, board and trains.
On board and trains?
Yeah.
You know, I know that there's some trainers out there who kind of poo-poo on them lately. I've seen some of that. Yeah. And I think that that's unfortunate because, you know, I've worked with a lot of people who maybe don't have the time or the skill set, right, to get their dog to a certain point in their training, but they definitely have the time and the skill set to maintain it. Right. So I don't think there's anything wrong with that at all. I think it's a great idea. I'm all for board and trains. I think that it's something if, you know, you want to make sure that your dog is really set up for success and you're worried about your own skills or ability or time, you know, to do that. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. A board and train is a fantastic option. And then, you know, and then maintain that training. Right.
Right.
The maintenance is a little easier, you know, than setting all of that up.
Right. Right. Yeah. That's a good point. I know some people, that don't like the boarding train, but man, letting professionals do stuff.
Right.
Man, come on.
I know. It's funny. You've seen it too. I've really seen kind of a lot of like, there's almost like this weird trend of people kind of like bashing people for boarding training lately. And I don't know where that narrative is coming from, but I completely disagree. I think it's a great idea.
Right, right, right. Exactly. Let's talk a little bit about your nutrition choices.
Mm-hmm.
You feed kibble, of course.
I do.
Right? Okay. Mm-hmm. What brands and different food have you tried and got the best out of? I know
Yeah.
it's different, but you know.
Yeah, I've tried a lot of the popular, you know, kibbles out there, right? Like mm-hmm. Purina Pro Plan. I've tried Merrick, Blue Buffalo, and I know you guys are all cringing right now. This was early on, right? Mm-hmm. And when you fall victim kind of to their marketing, you know,
right.
So I'd say I've tried them all, but I'll tell you that my dog did not do well on them. He had hot spots. He had something called leaky gut. And so he would throw up bile all the time throughout the day. Mm-hmm. I really struggled to put weight on him. Now he's fine, but as a puppy, this was my male Malinois many years ago. And so it kind of sent me on a search for a kibble that I could feed that was going to do well for him. And raw was not an option. I think that raw is the very best way you can go. Like, mm-hmm. I think if you have the time and you have the know-how, I think that's great. But what I see is a lot of people who feed raw don't really do it right. They're not doing it right. They're not doing it well. The dogs aren't really getting what they're needing. So mm-hmm. that makes me a little nervous because mm-hmm. I'm just too busy as it is to take on one more, you know, because I just thought, oh, I can't do this. Like, I'm going to have to stick to a kibble option for me.
Yeah.
And I found something called Munster. And it is a family owned, like local made in America brand in Munster, mm-hmm. Texas. And, they are, you know, it's all holistic. They have freeze-dried options. They do custom coating. And mm-hmm. that's kind of what sold me on it, right? Was the way that they made their food, the freeze-dried process, which is different from the freeze-dried process of a lot of the bigger brands who kind of suck mm-hmm. all the nutrition out. Mm-hmm. They have special dryers that maintain that. And it goes through a completely different process than most freeze-dried foods. Mm-hmm. And so I really liked that. And I loved that they had the custom coating option, which allows me to go make, like, you know, I have these three different Malinois and they all like different things, right? So Storm, for example, she hates fish. So she, you know, she doesn't like any kind of food with fish in it. Mm-hmm. But Riot did really well on that with his skin problems and his coat problems. Mm-hmm. And so I was able to kind of make these three different bags and they custom coat it. They roll it in those big barrels, you know, they coat it in all this little additives that I select, and they all three have a different food, but it comes from the same place and it ships straight to my door, and it's amazing. We've done very, very well on it. It's an all stages food as well, so you know, puppies to lactating bitches, I mean, it's all stages, so you can feed it at all times, which is also really cool.
Mm-hmm.
And it's just very rich,
right?
So they don't need a whole lot, they don't eat a whole lot of it, which helps with the waste. If you guys don't want to be picking up the yard every day with multiple dogs, that can be pretty messy and terrible.
Yeah.
So there's a lot of bonuses to it. A lot of things that make me very happy to feed it.
Right. Well, I want to tell you this. I'm glad you come on my channel because it's predominantly males dominant on my channel, but it has been a few women, but I can't say that about, especially within my breed, on the sports dogs. Some of the most dominant sports people in my breed are women.
Yeah.
Yeah. So it's good to see that. And have you faced any challenges? What is it out like out there? Is it a lot of women involved in sports and training and all this good stuff?
Yeah, I think there's a lot of women in PSA. And I don't know if that's just because that's who I'm lucky enough to be around, but yeah. But you know, there's a lot of women in our club. There's a lot of women that I train with. Mm-hmm. But I think that you're right. It's kind of like the more prominent figures or the more visible figures are men. Mm-hmm. And you know, I face a little bit of pushback, but not really in the sense that would, at least not seriously enough that it puts me off. Right.
Right.
I try to just kind of be a good sport and be Switzerland. That's literally my motto, is like, I am just here to train my dog and have a good time. And yeah. as long as that can align with you in some way, I'll figure out a way to network with you and make a relationship work with you. Right. You know, so whether it's men or women, it doesn't really matter to me, but I've loved seeing, you know, more women come online as far as dog training. And I good. Think a lot of women are stepping into this space now and just doing really, really well. So it's really fun to see.
They are. Yeah. And you don't put me in the mind of the type of person to get pushed around anyway.
No, I don't take shit. I don't. I just don't take any shit.
You was answering it all humble. Well, yeah. I know you don't take shit.
Yeah, don't let the blonde hair fool you. I'm mm-hmm.
right.
You know, I'll let you know if you cross a line, but you know, right. yeah. For the most part, we're just here to have a good time and train. And I think that most everybody gets along. You know, there's mm-hmm. there's the occasional, you know, creep that comes along, but that's the mm-hmm. world. That's the world we live in as women. You learn mm-hmm. how to deal with it and navigate it and move on. And there's nothing better than having a protection dog at your side anyway. Well, so
I'm telling you, right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, I tell you what, your journey has been impressive, and your marketing, your presentation is like, it's like top tier.
Thank you.
How did you learn that stuff? And what advice would you give to breeders and trainers on presentation?
Yeah.
Give me a little something on that.
Yeah. I mean, I would say this, first of all, you know, it's 2024, almost 2025. And if you're in the dog training space and you don't have a social media presence, mm-hmm. you've got to get one. You've got to start working on that. Your social media can really be your portfolio, right? Of, this is who I am. This is how I operate. Here's some of the things I can accomplish with dogs. Here's proof of that, right? Like if you don't have a social media presence where you can send a client to show them either before and afters or, you know, what your facility looks like, right? Like all of these things, then I would say whatever you're doing today, stop doing that and make it a priority. Like tonight, yeah. go spin up your social media tonight, right? Like it's that important.
Yeah.
But what I think is less important is actually the production value of things. And I'll kind of like explain that briefly because it's a huge hole we could dive into. But I think what you'll see is, right, if I'm going to approach some marketing things, I will approach marketing in the best way I can as far as how the presentation is put together and how I create an ad and all of that. But when it comes to my actual like content or my video content, I mean, I have good equipment to use and I could use it and film it very nicely with nice cameras and things, but I don't, because what I found is that, especially in the dog training niche, now this might not be true of other niches, right? Mm-hmm. But in the dog training niche, I feel like people want more authentic, real looking shot with my camera type mm-hmm. of in the moment, this is what's going on type of content, right? And so that doesn't require a $6,000 camera or a gimbal or fancy lights or anything at all, right? Exactly. People just want an authentic experience. And so for me, that has worked well, right? Yeah. And so there's a reason that my stuff looks that way. And then you'll see my ads look amazing. Those are two different things, different types of content that you create. But, you know, I think I think what it is kind of, it speaks a little bit to some of the just like natural things, natural traits that come out for me, as far as I'm a very detail oriented person. I'm someone who really cares strongly about the aesthetic of things. I just kind of have a natural eye for balance and lines and symmetry and things, right? Like, I just have always noticed that. Mm-hmm. And so I think that that's just a trait of mine that has come out when it comes to creating, you know, different projects or websites or ads or that kind of thing. It just presents itself that way. Cause I'll tell you, I didn't take any classes. I didn't work hard at it. I didn't, you know, like I don't have any secret. It's just sitting down and doing something and enjoying it.
Yeah. And then I think another thing is the world is ever changing. And then, you know, you have people that like, this and that, but people want information fast. Like, I was looking at a clip of yours. You had the dog in the heel position. And you was talking about positioning his head up and how you got it there.
Fading.
And it was, yeah, it was short to the point. Like, damn, okay, I got that.
Right.
You know, so yeah, that was really cool. Yeah,
people want that. You know, mm-hmm. I think sometimes dog trainers, they make the mistake of feeling like they have to sound overly educated or sound, you know, use a lot of buzzwords in their training, or, oh, we're going to use, you know, positive punishment to do this way. And it's like, mm-hmm. the average person doesn't really care. They don't care that you know those things. You should know those things. Don't get me wrong, right? But they don't care that you know those things. They just want the information delivered in a practical way that makes sense for them to go apply without all of that. So it's like, for example, the video you're talking about with the fading, I think that fading clip was probably less than a minute long. Mm-hmm. But if you think about it, fading is something you could spend an entire week or weekend teaching fading. Right? Just a seminar mm-hmm. on fading, how to fade the lure.
Right.
But if you can break it down into nice, quick informational content like that, that's what's going to kind of get your stuff recognized more in the social media realm, is like delivering quick, fast information.
How do you identify a good trainer? If I don't know anything about training, I need to get, I'm looking for somebody to get the basics from. What are some identifiers?
I want to see your dog. Mm-hmm. I want to see your dog. I want to see you work with your dog. I want to see a dog who, you know, has ears up, tails up, happy to work with you. Not a dog who comes out and they're healing like this, right? And their tail is tucked and they're, you know, there's signs to me that are like, basically, if you can come out and show me your dog, because your dog is your portfolio as a trainer. Mm-hmm. This is a showcase of everything you've been able to train and accomplish with an animal that mm-hmm. you had what would seem like unlimited time and resources to train, right? This is your personal dog. It mm-hmm. is your portfolio as a trainer. You should be able to pull that dog out and demonstrate some things with that dog. The dog should look happy. The dog should be engaged. The dog should want to work with you. And so really, I just always ask to see, you know, what does your dog look like? Bring it out. Show me. Work with the dog. That's really it. It's your portfolio. You know, you've got to have a dog who is happy to work with you first and foremost.
Right. Tools. The tools you use. What determines the tools do you use for as collars and things? Are you starting with a prone collar? You're starting with a flat collar? How does this work for you?
Yeah, that's a great question. I actually use those things as overlays throughout my training. I start with a naked dog. Nothing. Right. Food in hand. Young puppy, nothing. We're just going to learn how to move together. You're going to learn how to follow my hands. My hands are targets with food, and you're going to learn how to lure and move with me. I want synchronization. I want fluidity and movement. I want a dog who understands. A lot of people will just teach their dogs to do things on one side, typically the left, right? You're heeling on the left. I want my dog to heel on the left. I want him to heel on the right. I want him to heel frontwards. I want him to heel backwards. Like, actually, right? Like, I want a dog who knows how to move his body. Mm-hmm. When we get a good foundation in that, then I'll move to an overlay with a flat collar and a leash, mm-hmm. right? When we get good there, my overlays are going to move on to a prong collar if I need it for correction, right? Mm-hmm. And then, of course, my e-collar, which is also an overlay tool. But I'm never teaching new behaviors with tools. I'm really never offering correction in the teaching. So like there's three phases of teaching, right? There's the teaching phase, the generalizing phase, and then the maintenance phase. And in that teaching phase of learning, I'm never using corrections with the dog.
Right.
Just it's not fair. We're showing the dog how to do something, and we'll get there. You know, I have a marker for if the dog is incorrect, I say nope, and I spin away from the dog. But I don't offer a correction. Nope isn't followed with a correction, right? So, you know, I look at tools as overlays to the things that the dog already knows.
When you say you're not doing any correction, we're talking about at the puppy stage, right?
Right.
How long does this last?
Even if, not necessarily at the puppy stage, even if the dog is older and I'm showing the dog something new.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
Then I'm going to back all the way up. I mean, if it's a 4-year-old dog and I'm showing it something new, I would approach that the same way as if it was a puppy, right? Food in hand. Let me show you how to do this thing. We're in the teaching phase all over again.
Right. Right.
So no corrections would come.
Yeah.
And we're just going to have fun learning.
So let me ask you this. If you could sum up your training philosophy, how would you sum it up in a short sentence or two?
My philosophy is, first and foremost, have fun. You got to be in it for the right reasons. And I think that sometimes it's easy to lose that. It's easy to lose sight of that. It's easy to get frustrated. It's easy to get disappointed because this is a team effort, right? And so you're going to have good days and your dog is going to have good days and you're also going to have bad days. And so I think relationship, right, is just super, super important. It should be at the center of why you're working with the animal. And then, you know, my approach is just to go out and have a good time with my dogs. Really, I don't have some kind of structured plan or structured methodology. I don't subscribe to any one person's stuff, you know, like I'm not subscribed to NEPOPO. I don't subscribe to STS, even though I've done a lot of work with STS. I don't subscribe to Ivan's stuff. I'm just going to go out there and have a good time. My philosophy is I will go learn from everyone I can learn from. And I'll take this piece from here and this piece from here and that piece from that person. And I'll put it in my own little toolbox.
Yep.
And then I go do what works for me.
Yep. You built your own system.
Yeah. Right. Like, right. But I think what's important is to try to go learn from the best that you can. Right. So like my luring game was crap. Right. Like my dogs did not look fancy and quick and I couldn't figure out why. And it was my luring. So what did I do? I went to learn luring from the best person I could possibly find, which was Nino of STS Canine, mm-hmm. right? He's the very best at that thing. Mm-hmm. So if there's something you're struggling with, go learn that from that person, right? I didn't go to learn protection from him, or not that he can't do those things, right? But like, right. I went to learn that specific thing for him because I feel like he's at the top of that game. So that's mm-hmm. who I want to learn that skill from.
Oh man!
And then if you approach that, right? If you approach that way, you know, that each skill set in that manner, and you go learn from those people and you take the time to do that, all of a sudden you have a pretty unique, pretty cool toolkit, right?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. I'm so glad you said that, because being that I have a variety of guests, you get different perspectives,
mm-hmm.
and people kind of get it mixed up. You got to take the things that work for you. You know what I mean?
Yes.
And because some people are going to say, like, you have to do it this way. No,
oh, yeah.
Not true.
Yeah. No, they really do. You know, a yeah. lot of these schools that are out there, like, mm-hmm. like with NEPOPO, for example, with Bart Bellin, you're not allowed to do certain things.
Mm-hmm.
Like, you know, I don't know. There's a little bit of drama going on right now.
Let's talk about, I don't know. I've been hearing that NEPOPO. What is it?
NEPOPO is a system developed by Bart Bellin. He originates from Belgium.
Uh-huh.
And him and his wife have developed this school, right? It's a school for dog training, and it's kind of cut up into different layers. I think there's like silver, there's bronze, silver, gold, right? And then there's gold multiplicator, where now you're a teacher of their system, and it's just a very specific way of training dogs. I am not a NEPOPO student myself, but I know people who are. And you know, it's a huge commitment to go through their school, and it's many thousands and thousands and thousands and thousands of dollars to get all the way up there, right? And those upper
hey.
Levels of gold. Yes, it is a big enterprise.
Mm-hmm.
And you know, it's just one of those things, though, right? Like their program is very specific, and you're signing up to do that thing, and you have to do that thing.
Mm-hmm.
If you don't do that thing, your status can be revoked. Right. And that just doesn't jive with me. You know, no hate on Nipopo. I think it's a great system, but I wouldn't do it and forsake other ways of being able to train. So for that reason, it doesn't jive with me, but that's very common. Like, you know, his is more outwardly spoken, but a lot of trainers are that way. Just kind of like it's an unspoken and you can get ousted kind of, right? You find yourself on the outside suddenly if you do things a little differently, maybe than your trainer showed you, or you come up with a new way and then you show them and they say, oh no, you're doing it wrong. That's not how I showed you to do it.
Right.
Well, but the dog's doing it, right? Well, yeah. Well, okay. Let's move on.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah. Yeah. It's funny. Being that I cover all these topics, we got breeding war topics. We got training war topics.
Yes.
But at the end of the day, you got to do what's best for you.
100%.
I'm like you. I'm like anybody. Like, I always tell people, like, just doing this interview, I got something from you. I'm taking it. I'm putting it in the toolbox. And that's the way I do it. And I like people who can prove what they say. So,
same.
You know what I mean? So let me ask you this. I think I kind of asked you this already, but I know the Mal is your breed of choice. What are the biggest misconceptions on Malinois?
Yeah, you know, I think the biggest misconception is that they cannot be a pet, or they cannot be in a family, right? Or they can't be around children, or they can't, there's all these things that they can't do. It's almost as if they're perceived as some kind of robot dog who does nothing but just seek and destroy. And they're just, you know, and that's not the case. Now, there are some dogs that do have very, very high levels of drive that probably don't have any business being in a family environment, but you know, that's not the norm that's presented, right? And if you are seeking a dog that can do both, then it is possible to go find a breeder who's breeding for a nice balance, or maybe a medium to lower drive dog, right? Who you can go do some work with and have some fun with, but who can also come into the home and still be a pet. You know, and it's kind of worth saying, right? Because that's the stereotype, right? But it's kind of worth saying that, you know, even incredible lines where you think they're going to be just producing these drive monsters, right? Or these prey monsters. You think if they have 9 or 10 puppies in that litter, that all 10 of them are going to be prey monsters? Probably not. Right. Mm-hmm. And so there's probably 1 or 2 or 3 or 4 maybe, right, that are still going to find themselves to medium to low drive that still can absolutely go and fulfill a purpose. So, you know, I think that's the misconception, is people thinking that they're just these insane prey monsters that have no balance, but that's not the case. And even for dogs who are kind of, you know, higher drive prey monster type dogs, you know, you, with the right training, you can learn how to leverage that drive into behavior, right? So it's all about your approach and what you're equipped to do. And some technical skill does come into play there. So you kind of have to take an honest assessment of yourself, right? What you're able to do, what you're committed to doing as well.
Okay. Let's step down in the fire one more time.
Yeah. So, I'm here for it.
So what's your favorite breeds to train, and what are your least favorite breeds to train, and why?
So obviously my favorite breed to train is a Malinois. I think that goes without saying. I especially love working with Malinois puppies. They are just little sponges. I always say they're easy to train, but that's funny to me, because easy to me and to a lot of other people seems insane. But it's just, they're just these little sponges, and they're such a special dog when they're that small. They're so fun to work with. But you know, as far as like dogs that are my least favorite to work with, I'll tell you, I really don't work with dogs that aren't Malinois.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah.
if you don't have a Malinois, I probably won't work with you.
Yeah.
I have a couple neighbors that I worked with, right, in my neighborhood that had doodles, and that was a miserable experience. So, I stick with the Malinois. It's kind of my niche.
Hey, one thing about niches, you carve them out, you stick to it.
That's right.
It'll grow.
Exactly.
Yep. So you've been on this journey for some years now. What is your end goal? You know, where do you see Maligator Mom in the next 5
or 10? Oh, gosh. I would like to get more serious about sport. I would like to find a dog who I felt excited about training in sport, and I don't currently have that dog. So I'm still looking for that dog. I'd love to see that happen in the next 5 years, of course. Mm-hmm. And then I'm really enjoying focusing on my project right now of my virtual learning stuff. Like I'm having a really good time doing that, and I think there's a need for it. And so I think it's kind of groundbreaking. I don't really know of anybody else that's doing it quite like that. And so I think it's kind of an unparalleled experience that that I'm trying to kind of carve out for people. And like I was saying, the next one I have coming up is in February of 2025, and enrollment is open for that right now at maligatormom.com. You can kind of learn more about that and see all the different speakers we have in, which I mentioned earlier, just an amazing group of just the talent pool there that you can tap into is just incredible. I don't think that there's anything like it where that many people have come together of that caliber to put out information to a group of people. And right. It's completely virtual. And that's really where I see myself kind of focusing is really trying to kind of develop this virtual thing. Like I did virtual mentorships this year. And that kind of led me to the space of, I want it bigger, right? Like right. I was doing these 30-day mentorships. And I thought, oh, we can do this bigger. We can do this better. We can bring more people in. We can grow this. Like how's that going to look? And so that's kind of where I'm at right now. And I'm enjoying that. And we'll see, you know, how it turns out, but that's kind of what I'm swimming towards.
Hey, so far from what I see, you've been doing an excellent job, and I know you're going to get wherever you want to go. So
thank you.
Yeah. And we need more people like you that are resources to, and as far as education and things like that on dogs. And I'm going to wrap this up, and okay. I really enjoyed this. Anything else you want to tell the people before we get out of here?
Go. If you're interested in Malinois breed education or training education in general of working dogs, especially drivey dogs, check me out on social media, TikTok, YouTube, Instagram, Facebook. I'm all over the place, and it's all the same, just Maligator Mom. I'd love to connect with anybody who's interested in learning more. So you can shoot me a DM across any of those, medias. And yeah.
That's what's up.
Awesome. All right, Thanks so much for having me.
Hey, yeah. We thank you for coming. I want everybody to go over there, follow her, Instagram popping, our YouTube channel's popping. Go over there, say NWA sent me.
There you go. Love it.
All right. We thank you so much.
Thank you so much for having me. This was a great time.
All right. We'll catch you in the whirlwind.
All right.
All right.
Bye-bye.
And that wraps up another episode of NWA Cane Corsos. Thank you for being a part of our Cane Corso community. Remember, you can stay connected with us beyond the podcast. Find us on all major media platforms by searching for NWA Cane Corsos. Whether it's Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, or YouTube, just hit that follow button to join the conversation and get the latest updates. If you have a burning question or want to apply to be a guest on our show, we'd love to hear from you. Simply shoot us an email at nwacanecorsos@gmail.com. And if you're a business interested in becoming a sponsor, reach out to us at the same email address. For more resources, exclusive content, and links to all our social media profiles, visit our website at nwacanecorsos.com. It's your go-to destination for everything dogs. Thank you once again for tuning in, and we can't wait to bring you more exciting episodes where we explore the fascinating world of dogs.